Dredge kind of pushed it by the wayside because the collateral damage.
Yep.
It's like, this kind of splashing over. If I'm going to play a graveyard-based deck, you just go to Dredge.
Yep.
But we've definitely seen kind of a resurgence with the Abzan Company decks. And Aether Vault, the newest edition that that Frank Ford is playing here, is...
the Renegade Rallier.
Renegade Rallier.
Yeah, card's so phenomenal.
Yep, card is very good. You want to talk a little bit about that card before we go too deep in that game?
Absolutely. So it's a 3-mana 3/2 that has Revolt on it. When it enters the battlefield, if you had a permanent leave the battlefield this turn, then you're allowed to return a card with converted mana cost 2 or less from your graveyard to the battlefield.
Yep.
What is beautiful about the Abzan Company decks is most of your permanents cost 3 or less. So you have a lot of really, really powerful hits, and it can ramp you if you go fetch land, rally, or return fetch land to the battlefield.
Yep. And that's, I think that's like one of the most beautiful interactions is Revolt. Very, very easy to turn on Modern.
Absolutely.
Like Fatal Push, basically a 1-mana destroy target creature with
converted mana cost 4 or less.
Yep.
We had a remand coming down on the Kitchen Finks. It's really good for Fabiano. Kitchen Finks is a very hard threat to deal with for a Grixis deck like this.
So it looks like Fabiano is just on, looking at his deck list here, pretty standard.
It's like a control version of it, not a Delver version.
Yeah, so
Grixis, Damnation's main board. Ashiok. I like the spice in Ashiok. I think it's a really good Planeswalker.
Yep. So pretty standard Grixis control deck. Another deck that has also kind of gained traction.
Yep. Fatal Push is really phenomenal. Yep. Like, your Snapcaster interactions are so much better now. You need 3 mana to kill things instead of a 4 mana for the Terminates.
Yep.
And you don't have to be as mana intensive anymore either.
Right.
You just need black and blue for the Fatal Push rather than black, blue, red.
Right.
So I think it plays very, very well in situations like this.
Right. So kind of a slow start. Just remands, your typical draw some cards, fill up your hand.
Yeah, Fabiano likes a start like this. He doesn't like the Kitchen Finks because Kitchen Finks is a threat that keeps coming back.
Yep.
Like, the Kwasali Pride Mage eating a Lightning Bolt is fine. We trade 1 for 1 on that, but the Finks is going to be much harder to deal with. I don't see... There's no Kalidus' main board for Fabiano. He's got them in the sideboard, so we'll probably see those coming in game 2. Those are very powerful against this deck.
Yep. Okay, so there is the first Cryptic Command.
Yeah, Cryptic Command, counter draw. Yeah.
Our first real catch-all.
Yeah, that card. Yeah. That's the one card I hate out of blue decks when I'm playing my Jund lists.
Right.
The card's just too good, too many modes.
It's really nice to see blue decks kind of make a strong push in Modern. We've kind of seen like little blips. Like we had Splinter Twin as like... Kind of, that was obviously like one of the better decks. The
premier control deck at that point.
Right. But after this banning of Splinter Twin, we obviously had the Eldrazi decks where control decks were just completely non-existent.
Nothing was existent other than Eldrazi.
And then we kind of had Smattering here and there, but with Ancestral Visions coming off, I think Grixis Control and Jeskai decks to a lesser extent have
They started picking up steam.
Yep.
Grixis had a much better time with the Delve creatures, but once the Jeskai deck picked up the Nahiri-Emrakul combo, then they were back to the Splinter Twin Ode, but it wasn't something you could just instantly combo, kill your opponent, and they can't really interact with you. Right. It was a very sorcery speed combo.
So, it looks like Frank is having a little bit trouble with his mana. I think
we just drew a land. And we have what it looked like a Linvala Preserver and a Cord of Calling in hand.
Okay. Yeah, Cord is one of those quietly probably one of like the better cards in Modern by very large
margin. Yeah, I think it's a secretly overpowered card that not many people are kind of looking at.
Yeah. It's one of those things with a very, very high ceiling in the decks that can fully take advantage of it.
Absolutely. Eternal Witness returning Voice of Resurgence to the battlefield. Very, very powerful.
Yep. And that's one of the things about this deck. It's one of those things that it looks like a combo deck. It has all the combo pieces, but at its core... But
a value game very well.
Right.
A creature beat down value game, which is really, really powerful.
Right. And we've seen this in the past. Kind of like all the core decks kind of have that synergy. Mm-hmm. Cord allows for very, very powerful end step... or whenever you tap my guys, get my combo pieces, kill you. It always has that. But fundamentally, it's just eventually I'm just going to grind you out. Just play my voice, play my Kitchen Finks. You kill these, you have more threats to deal with because they're all 2-for-1 type cards.
Yes. Kitchen Finks comes back. Voice of Resurgence makes a token.
Yep.
Everything's just something else attached to it, which is really good.
Which is really what you want to be doing, and that's kind of how you kind of overwhelm the control decks.
Yeah. Because I like the way Frank's deck looks. Actually, looking at the list, he's got Goyf's main board.
Yep.
So he's a lot less dedicated combo and a lot more, I want to hit awesome things with my collected companies.
Right, right. Another one of those secretly, like, very powerful cards in Modern.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Like, I shouldn't say secret because...
Yeah, the cat's out of the bag because of Standard.
Right. So Standard kind of... I think Standard was really what brought attention to, oh, we have all these powerful cards in Modern because, you know, Modern is the type of format where you really want to be playing 1s, 2s, and 3s.
Yeah.
And Collected Company just kind of puts it over the top with how powerful some of them are.
Yeah, because you can get up to 6 mana worth of creatures for 4 at instant speed.
Right. Especially when you're looking at things like, oh, I put Eternal Witness into play, get back my Collected Company, right? Now you have my Eternal Witness to deal with, my other creature like Collected Company into to deal with, and now I have a Collected Company in my hand again. So, and that really puts a strain on Gerard because he can't really tap down, right? Because Collected Company is one of those cards. Like, yeah, like, it sucks to have to deal with the voice, blah, blah, blah. But now, like...
This situation, for example, Gerard's casting a Damnation, cleaning up 2 creatures, Kitchen Fin comes back, Frank gains more life. Frank has the company in hand, so he has the ability to cast company now at the end step.
Yep.
Granted, Gerard still has mana open,
right?
So Frank's slow start is going to hurt him a little bit in this situation.
Right.
But for Frank to be able to cast company here, get it countered by a 2-mana spell... Gerard only has 1 mana open after that, and he can get the voice on the floor, and anything after this, you know, Gerard can't play on Frank's turn anymore.
Right.
Cord for...
Yep, so...
As Cord been, for, what, 4? No.
2.
1, 2, 3. Yeah, Cord for 2?
Yep.
Probably want... we can get a piece of the combo here, right?
We can get a combo piece, we can get a voice, we can get Anafenza, we can get Quasali Pride Mage, Tarmogoyf. There's a Goyf you're talking about.
I believe Goyf, at this point, I believe Goyf's lethal because we have an artifact in the graveyard.
We do have an artifact creature, instant sorcery. So Goyf is currently a 4/5.
We should have a land as well.
Land from Windswept Heath.
So I think Goyf by itself is lethal, which is great for the Kitchen Fink because now the Kitchen Finks can start pushing damage.
Right.
And if Frank resolves the Voice of Resurgence prior, then Gerard's forced to act before attacks, which is great.
Right. That's, again, one of the, like, the most powerful aspects is you're not combo-centric. You can see he has a cord. He can get whatever he wants. He doesn't even care about getting a combo piece, right? Yeah. He's just going straight for a throat here. This is a lethal creature. I'm still chipping in with my Kitchen Finks.
Mm-hmm.
It's becoming harder and harder for you to make plays, especially if my cards are all going to be 2-for-1s from here going out.
Yeah.
So lots of strain on Gerard here. This hit, it looks like it'll put him down to 3. Unfortunately, no Siege Rhino that we sometimes see in...
lists like this.
Yep.
Yeah.
But there's a Murderous Red Cap. We're not far red away from good. Just...
Red Cap.
Red Cap kill you type thing.
Red Cap's going to be very hard for Gerard to deal with because none of the removal spells that he plays stops it from coming back.
Yep.
So it'll just be lethal if he can cast it.
Yep. And here's the voice you're talking about. Yeah. So now
that we got Gerard to tap down very low, if we can get the voice on the floor, Gerard can't do anything on Frank's turn anymore.
Right. And without a clean answer like Path to Exile, you have to deal with the voice itself and the token it makes.
Yep. And at this point, the token's going to be the exact same size as the voice is right now.
Right.
So we're still staring at lethal even if we remove the voice from play.
Right. And Frank still has 3 cards in hand. He's not even out of gas yet. That's the...
This is good right here. The Colgan's Command shocking the Voice of Resurgence, making Frank discard a card. Hopefully Frank remembers his Voice of Resurgence trigger.
He pointed at it, so...
I think Frank has a path in hand.
Okay.
So for me personally, I'd be ditching the path, I think, before I would ditch Linvala. Linvala being a flying threat, I think, is phenomenal against Gerard. He's got no ways to deal with the flying threat other than removal spells. Another shock discard.
Okay.
Please. All right, so we're getting rid of the path. We still have a collecting company in hand, which I think is phenomenal. Gerard only has 2 mana open. He's got a land and a card in hand, it looks like.
So here he's actually managed to maintain equity. He's actually not really losing cards, as it were.
And then Dreadboard.
Okay.
All right, this is pretty good for Frank. Gerard has 1 card in hand, all tapped out, so we can go collected company into 2 threats right here.
I believe he's short man. I think he's fetching now. I think he only has...
No, we have four. There's two up here. Collect the company.
Those are tapped?
Yeah, no, he's going to untap and have...
Oh, sure. Collect it. Sorcery speed, collect it. Okay. Yep.
I mean, against Fabiano, like, the things that I would be worried about are, like, remand and cryptic.
Okay.
And he can't cast anything right now. And if we hit decent threats off of this Coco, like... Eternal Witness and another Kitchen Finx.
Right.
Damnation doesn't do much either.
There's a voice. There's
voice and a noble. Okay. So that's a lethal voice or resurgence.
Yep. And Jar's...
The token is lethal as well.
Yep. And, I mean, no joke, Noble Hire chips in for damage as well. Even if he has two clean answers to a voice, you're still getting him with a Noble Hierarch.
So. Yeah, I think if we draw an answer, I think it's got to be the voice or the Noble Hierarch. Because if it's just Voice of Resurgence, then it's only two damage. And then we can probably, like, maybe draw a Tazigar or something to block the voice with.
Right.
I don't even see Tazigar in the list.
So Sleight of Hand does give him a redraw. Let's see what we're getting.
We're not even playing Delve creatures.
Are there his creatures in this deck? One Jace, four Snapcaster Mages. Or no, I'm sorry. Two Jaces, four Snapcaster Mages.
I think that's it.
Those are the only creatures, it looks
and
like.
And then we have two Lilianas, two Ashioks, and a Jace Architect of Thought. So we're very heavily into the control plan right now.
Right. So it looks like while we were talking about that, we just saw Cryptic Command bounce the voice.
Gives him so we can still chip in for damage, which is very good.
Yep.
Still has three turns before he dies. Voice could catch a counterspell here. That's fine.
If it looks like he's reaching... I can't see what the last
card...
Is it
another voice? It's another voice.
Is there a voice? Okay.
That's... I don't see Fabiano coming back from that. The only thing I can even think of at this point is just going Cryptic Command, tap down your creatures, buy another turn.
Right.
He drew a Liliana for turn. He's got a Liliana land. There's nothing he can do at this point.
Yeah.
All right. So again, Cletus is out of the sideboard for Fabiano are going to be very, very powerful in this matchup if they can stay on the floor.
Core time is the deck functions, in my opinion, very, very poorly on the draw. Mm-hmm. When your best thing to do turn one is suspend Ancestral Visions, which granted is a very powerful thing.
Or hit him with a discard spell because Fabiano is playing the black.
Right. When you can only do those things on turn one and you're on the draw, sometimes you're already on the back foot when your opponent gets to go first. Turn one, Noble Hierarch, it's like, I need the bolt, but now I'm not getting my serum visions, so... I'm not fixing my draws. Ancestral Vision takes a whole nother turn.
Yep. You go from, I want to set up a little bit against you to I need to bolt this creature, otherwise I'm going to start falling behind very fast.
Right. Okay, so now we have double Ancestral Visions.
Tap land and second Ancestral Visions.
Okay.
No turn one draw, which is
a little surprising.
Rough. Right? Yeah. Granted, you know what I mean, we have five birds total.
Two noble hierarchs, three birds.
So we've got five dorks. So.
Two Viscera Seers, but not really one of the premium turn one.
Turn ones, absolutely.
So in the long game, Gerard, I really like him here. Yeah. But the thing about the company deck is it has so much resilience, it has so many 2-for-1s, you really don't want to run out of resources going into the late game.
Absolutely.
Yep. So
Scavenging is very, very powerful against a deck like this. So I'm curious as to see what Gerard's going to do.
He'll probably take a few hits from it. No creatures.
Yeah. Not really anything important to be targeted in graveyards.
Yep.
Not worried about losing anything for his Snapcaster Mages at this point.
Yep.
There's the Selfish Spirit we were talking about.
Yep. Let's see if this is end step or if this is in response.
Probably end step if we're going tapped.
Yep.
The only thing I can think of would be the remand. Because we can't cast Terminate quite yet.
Yep.
So we draw another vision.
Cletus? Or
Cryptic Command. Knight of Souls Betrayal is phenomenal.
Okay. Alright, so that also came out of the sideboard. I think that was one of the things that... Lots of one toughness creatures, you can shut off the combo.
Second half of Kitchen Finks gets killed.
Yep.
You get rid of the Viscera Seer combo portion.
Yep.
I think it's good. Yep. Spellskite dies to Lightning Bolt now.
Yep, that's true.
Ooh, Fulminator Mage. Fulminator Mage actually really powerful here. If we go after the Steam Vents, Gerard has one blue source, and he's got a Cryptic Command in his hand. But again, we're drawing four cards right now.
Yep.
So it's likely we're going to find another blue source. There's a Blood Moon came out of the sideboard, too.
Yep.
That is... I want to say that's pretty bad for Frank.
The problem is Fabiano kind of locks himself out.
Well, he's got an island in his hand, actually.
Okay, there is an island. Yeah. Okay, I did not see that.
So he's got an island on the floor, two swamps on the floor, and another island in his hand. Frank is in a little bit of trouble, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay.
Frank does have a swamp, so he got a little lucky in that regard.
Yep. So he's not he's still able to cast spells.
Yeah. It's going to be very tough, though, because I think he only runs at best. No, he's got three forests and one plains.
Three forests, one plains, one swamp.
Okay.
So let's see if he continues to get to play magic here.
Yeah, I see an Anafenza in his hand. I see a Cord of Calling.
Alright, so attack for two. See if... no follow-up play. The second Ancestral Visions comes off. I think from here, Jar is in pretty good position. His life total is still reasonably high. He's mitigating a lot of the damage with Nicehold's Betrayal. Blood Moon is in play.
Yeah, we're flipping Jace, so we have an active Planeswalker on the floor.
Yep. So and this further slows down Frank's
development.
Frank's development and his clock.
Just go for a damnation.
Okay.
Yeah, sack the Fulminator Mage. Hit one of the mountains.
This looks to be pretty good. So there was a second island you were talking about. So it looks like he's not really hurting on mana. He has all colors unlocked.
He's hurting a little on red, technically, but...
That's true.
Any land we play that's not a basic from here, it's going to be a mountain.
But realistically, there's a Cryptic Command that he can now cast with the third island.
And Frank needs to hit any one of the four remaining basics in his deck.
Yeah.
Luckily, Gerard does not have the ability to win a fast game. So we're going to be able to sit here for a little while. Frank's going to be able to draw out of the position he's in, but it's going to be one of those... Is it too late already?
Right.
You know, do you have three Cryptics and two Snapcaster Mages in your hand? Sure, I'm not going to be able to cast a spell for the rest of the game.
He's already discarded twice.
Yeah, second Blood Moon, just rubbing it in a little bit. Ooh, four mana? Murder Shred Cap, okay. Castable spell. Cryptic Command also very good.
All right, and Frank's had enough.
Yeah. So. Frank knows when he's beat.
Yep. It will probably pass the point where he can probably stack his deck, and it realistically won't.
Let's set up my draws and dig for my basics.
Right.
But, like, I got him to the point where he was at enough life where I could double bolt him. So I was like, look at the top three. It's card, bolt, card. And I just put the cards in the graveyard, put the bolt on top, and then just untapped and bolted him to death.
Right.
So my mountains helped a little bit, and I think that's why Blood Moon's not quite as good against Jund, because you're still giving them an access to play on.
Right.
Whereas like against Abzan, if Abzan doesn't fetch any of their basics out, they have zero access to play on.
Right.
This guy, Frank has a little bit with the red cap and the Fulminator Majors, luckily.
Right.
But outside of that, not too much. And that's why I like Fulminator Majors against Jund, even though it's not as powerful, you can cast it through Blood Moons.
Right. So here, both players did keep seven, leading off. Frank, kind of on a slow start again. Looks like he kept a seven.
And again, fetching the God of the Shrine, we talked about how we want to be more conscious about our basics. So either he's got basics in hand, or more fetch lands. Right. I see at least the Windswept Heath in hand.
Right. Looks like his draws the Aven Mind Sensors that we did talk about earlier, that they get brought in.
A very powerful effect if you can get it where you need it to be.
Right.
But is this our only land in hand? I think I see another land. Might be one of the Gavinies. But hopefully he goes for a basic forest here.
I assume he has a 2-drop. It's kind of hard to envision. If you have no 1-drop into no 2-drop, I have a hard time imagining the kind of sets of cards he would keep where that would be.
No 1, no 2 on the play. Like, this is prime time for you to go aggressive against Fabiano.
Right. Play Voice, play... Okay, Tarmogoyf.
Goyf's okay.
Okay.
Goyf lives played. Through Bolt, so that's something that we're okay with at this point.
Yep, currently 2-3. So we do see that Gerard's draw there was a Blood Moon, so he did keep those in.
Yeah, I think Blood Moon's very powerful. We saw what it did
right to
him the first game.
Again, with no Man Dork here, it's very possible he just gets shot out of the game if he doesn't have some sort of answer.
So we got a swamp in hand. I just noticed we have a swamp. Yep. It looks like swamp in a Gavinny township.
Okay.
Yeah, there's the township. Ship with the Goyf.
Yep. So here...
Fabiano do his thing. Pass turn. Interesting.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
Does Gerard have a third land for the Blood Moon?
He probably does after the remand draw into draw. Yeah. I'm worried about the Blood Moon, though. So another thing about casting Blood Moon too early when it's yours is if you don't have the mana, you're locked out of playing spells. And at this point, we have a 3-4 Goyf to worry about.
Right.
So if you can't cast spells versus the 3-4 Tarmogoyf, it's just going to eat you up.
Right, you're kind of shooting yourself in the foot. And we've definitely seen games in the past. As
I've played games where like where I played the Blood Moon, I just died to the random creature.
Right, just kind of like shot yourself in the foot.
Yeah.
Shot yourself in the foot, slowly bled out over time. And
absolutely. So, Blood Moon, another, as much as it is one of those, like, shut off the ability to play magic buttons,
it's a two-way also, street.
Yeah, it really is. Yeah. If you're not prepared for it, you're going to be in trouble.
Right. So, I think that's kind of what Jar is conscious of. I think he does want to develop his mana a little bit more. Develop his mana a little bit more, get a little bit more going, have ways
to We're going to have an active Planeswalker in a turn.
Yep.
I think... I wasn't a huge fan of Frank's Kitchen Finks there. I think that should have been a Aven Mind Sensor turn where we pass back. If Fabiano does something, then we can sneak the Mind Sensor in while he's tapped out. If he goes for the fetch, we can sneak it in while he's fetching.
I agree.
Granted, it probably eats the remand, but he can't cast the Blood Moon. And that's something I would be conscious of when Fabiano untaps for his third turn.
I agree. He has no current way to deal with the Jace, which actually is a little worrisome. Jace is one of those cards.
Jace is going to flip right now. Yeah. And like the -2/-0 is great against the 3-4 Tarmogoyf.
Yep. We'll see what he decides to do here.
We got Collected Company in hand. We've got the Mind Sensor. We've got Renegade Rallier.
Okay, so he has
more than one company.
So I think with both Aven Mind Sensor.
Mage as well.
Okay.
Hey, we got a lot of really good options here.
Okay.
All right, I like it.
Okay.
He went for the Fulminator Mage. We're going to go right for the Steam Vents, probably.
Yep. The Steam Vents is a little bit better than a Spar Bluff Canal because he could be playing like a Dragon Skull Summit, the kind of cycle lands where they come into play.
Yeah, no. So, the Grixis decks past have played those cards.
Yep.
But I think now that we have the Spire Bluff Canals, they don't need to.
Right.
Yeah, and I don't see any of
so the So I think this might be lands. I think this might be the Blood Moon turn. We do see a basic fetched out here.
Yeah, so we have one of each basic now.
Yep.
It's going to be tough for Frank because our basic on this side is the swamp instead of a forest. If it was a forest, we'd be in great shape.
Right.
We could still cast our collected companies. Yeah. And every draw from here on out is just going to be a mountain, I think, for the most part. Again, we're back to the four basics in library. And... here's the power of Jace.
Yep.
Block, flip, take no damage. Jace takes no damage. Draw Ashiok. So we're going to get a second Planeswalker on the floor.
Yep.
Jace is going to be able to tick up, make the Goyf smaller, make him way less of a threat. And Gerard is going to probably end up casting more spells out of Frank's deck than he is now that we have Ashiok.
Right. And I think the kind of the turning point in this game here was I think I would like to see Frank keep his mana open, either go for the Collected Company or the Aven Mind Sensor, instead of just running the Fulminator Mage out there.
So the Fulminator Mage was powerful, and if it did make Gerard stumble, it would have been phenomenal for us.
Right.
But again, we have Collected Company in hand. We can cast Fulminator Mage through Blood Moon.
Right.
So I would have prioritized the spells that I can't cast while Blood Moon's on the floor.
I agree. So Frank's turn, he untaps. We did see the Ashiok come down. I think this is the part where Frank is slowly going to get overwhelmed in cards. The two Planeswalkers provide...
Looks like he's still attacking Fabiano's life total, which is great. If we can get another card type in graveyard, Fabiano would be dead in two turns on board. But granted, we have a lot of cards in hand. Inquisition of Kozilek.
Alright, so this is the first look at Frank's hand here. Yeah.
Cord, Finks, Mind Sensor,
Company,
Rallier.
So honestly, none of these matter.
Yeah, none of them matter. I think the best card I think in the hand is probably the Rallier.
Yep.
That we can take because we can't hit the Collected Company. We are nowhere near ever casting Cord of Calling.
Right.
We need one Planes for the Mind Sensor.
Yeah.
And we need a Plains and a Forest for the Rallier.
Yeah, so the Mind Sensor might be the first thing, especially since that kind of disrupts the fetch land draws or whatever.
Yeah, and Fabiano's missing land drops at this point.
Yep. So reasonably close game. It's, I think Fabiano definitely does have the advantage, but it's not clear that Ford is necessarily just out of the game.
I think he's close.
It's getting there. Each passing turn, if he doesn't actually do something, if he brings in the Murdus red caps, that's a nice roadblock for multiple turns.
How many Murdus? We have one red cap?
Only one red cap.
Yep. Yeah, and Fabiano hit it on the Ashap plus.
Yep.
We can't cast it yet because we need a few more than that, but we're going to hit him again. If we can hit something reasonable off of that, Thrun.
Okay.
Pretty phenomenal.
That card is quite good.
Great hit, so Frank can't have it.
Sure.
Right. Granted, we still can't cast our spells.
Right. I think at this point, Frank just wants to hit basic.
Yeah.
Because I
think back to the turn two when we fetched out the Overgrown Tomb for Tarmogoyf. If we just hit Forest there, I think the game goes much, much better.
Right. If we had gone fetch... Oh, there it is. Okay, so there's a Forest, so he does get to play.
All right. We have a little bit of magic incoming.
All right, so a little bit more magic.
Yeah, I would be worried for sure, I think, at this point about Remand, because that is about the only spell Fabiano can reasonably cast. We can't cast Cryptics because Spire Bluff is a mountain.
Right.
Right? He can't cast the Damnation in his hand either because we don't have double black for that.
Yep.
So Fabiano is a little hurting off of this Blood Moon. Granted, it's not terrible, but it's a little painful for sure.
All right, so we shrink the Tarmogoyf, probably going to play the Thrun. So now these two creatures are just kind of bouncing off each other. No real headway to be made in either direction here.
Yeah. We do have a Collected Company, at least on the horizon. We have a Remand in the graveyard, Snap Remand.
Okay, so a temporary fix. No really permanent one.
No. I'm okay, I think, with main phasing the Remand, or the Collected
Company. I agree. Get him while he's tapped out.
Yeah, we're absolutely tapped out. Granted, if he draws another black source, we're in a little bit of trouble.
Yep. Has to do it now. Spin the wheel. Played this game before. Look at top six. Sometimes you hit two, sometimes...
I played back when it was a four-color setup, when we had Savage Knuckleblade and Mantis Rider. And those were my favorite days.
All right. So now, I think it has gotten a little bit closer. Voice, definitely one of the heavier hitters in this. Still gets brick-walled by Thrun, so we're kind of at a standstill.
He just drew the swamp, too.
So there's a second swamp.
Activate Damnation.
So it ticks up. See if he runs out the Damnation here. It seems like he probably does.
Kalidus prior to Damnation. Okay. A little bit awesome, I would have to say. Anafenza, Voice of Resurgence, Self... Wow, that was... Okay. All very good hits.
He can't cast any of those, so...
True.
It's definitely good
for Fabiano getting access to them is also great. Because if he draws another land and casts the Selfless Spirit, the Damnation's going to be amazing.
Right.
So you just sacrifice the Selfless Spirit, make all of his creatures indestructible, cast a Damnation, wipe out all of the three creatures on Frank's side, get three zombies, and then this game is very, very locked up.
Yes. So there's the Damnation draw.
Second Damnation. I think Fabiano is clearing up the ability to cast the Damnation, get all of the zombies with Kalidus.
Yep. I wonder if he doesn't realize that he can play the Selfless Spirit. I mean, clearly he really does realize he can play.
Yeah, I think he's leaning towards the Damnation. A land drop here would have been phenomenal because then we could have done that. Think at this point we're at 7 life. Frank's got some good cards. If Frank draws a removal spell for all right, so we don't have to tap mana for that, do we?
Nope. You're removing loyalty. That's how you're casting.
Correct.
Yep.
Remove loyalty. Sacrifice self-spirit. There it is. Yep. Cast Damnation. Okay.
Yep.
Ooh, Frank has the ability to Court of Calling. So we have Voice of Resurgence and Tarmogoyf.
And of course, you are correct. So
he can Court up a Selfless Spirit and make all of his stuff indestructible. Or if you can cord up something that gets rid of Kalidus. I don't think that would be all that fantastic either.
It doesn't really do anything, so... See what he's doing. He's tapping a lot of mana. It looks like a cord for seven. Three. Seven, cord for three.
Sure, what we would cord for.
Yep, there is a selfless spirit.
The only thing I could think of in a situation like that would be cord for Eternal Witness to cord again, but we don't have enough mana for that.
Right. That is definitely a sweet play, though. Definitely yeah. One of the crazy chains you can really get going.
Alright, everyone's indestructible.
Alright.
Fabiano has some really great attacks, I think, if he wants to. Yeah, he's going for it. Full yep. seven.
Full seven, game for three. Yep. So Ford falls to nine. Fabiano goes up to 10. Shrinks
the Goyf. Frank's going to pay to redirect the spell sky.
Yep. So actually, reasonably close here. It depends Absolutely. On how much depends on how much gas Ford still has in his hand.
I think that's drew.
A kitchen
we
face.
Can't draw a red cap.
You can't draw. So there's a rallier that I see with no white, which is a little unfortunate.
I see a land.
Probably mountain in his hand.
Yeah, I think it's a Verdant Catacombs.
Okay.
Again, wildly different game if we have a turn two forest.
That is very true.
Some of the hits under Ashiok might actually be on the floor for us because we'll be able to cast the company much, much earlier.
Right.
And we have a Snapcaster Mage over there as well.
Yep. So lots of roadblocks.
The Dark Ascension token's a zombie token from yep. Kalidus.
Where are we at here? Looks like a bit of a judge call, so kind of just sit tight here, see what's happening. Don't quite see anything.
Okay.
I think they're talking about when the trigger was supposed to happen for Cletus, which in fact is not a trigger, so that's actually not something that can be missed. Some questions.
Yeah, chat just mulling over what happened with Damnation.
Okay. So it does look like they're talking about how Cletus... The timing on Cletus. Again, it's not something you can miss because it's a replacement effect.
Yeah,
it's not a trigger.
It has to happen.
It does have to happen.
The token. Fabiano brought in a lot more cards than I thought he was going to in a matchup like this. Mm-hmm. You know, we saw the Knight of Souls Betrayal, all the Kalidus's. We saw Blood Moons. I don't think we saw the Thing in the Ice. Did we see Fabiano play a Fulminator Mage? I don't think we did.
No Fulminator Mage. No,
but yep. Frank did.
Frank was the one who played. He was played multiple Fulminator Mages.
Yeah.
Okay, I think we're going to
come back to us.
Yep, we're paying away just for a second while they resolve the call. So one of the things I'm curious about, this is one of the things that has come up in Standard when Coco was one of the bigger decks.
Okay.
Where do you stand on Dispel coming in against Collected Company if your only targets are Collected Company and now we know about Court of Calling, obviously. So looking at this deck, we have two cords, four Collected Companies, two paths, which may or may not be in the deck still. So where do you stand on Dispel in this? It's come up in Standard, obviously, because we did see...
Yeah, I think what it is that the Standard answers are so much more narrow. I think we want to Dispel a little bit more.
Okay.
But I think in Modern, we don't need it as much. We have more Thoughtseize effects, Remand effects, much more efficient ways to deal with the Collected Companies themselves. So I don't think it's necessary in matchups like this.
Okay.
And I get what else does Standard play? Standard had, like... Dromoka's commands, all right.
We have companies,
Dromoka's commands, and something else.
Yep. But the thing about company was they would actually cut their Dromoka commands post sideboard, depending on if you were on the player or on the draw.
Okay.
So you kind of had this weird game where how good is the spell type thing. So, yep. I vaguely remember bringing it in on the play, not on the draw.
Yeah.
So
I never played much of the Bant Company decks. I was on something else during that format.
Bant Company was great. You missed out.
Bant Company was great. I don't remember what I was even playing at that point in time.
So I had kind of this weird cycle where I at one point played something similar to a company list in Modern. I think I just wanted to determine. It was a PPTQ. I just went 0-3. Just like 0-3, done for a day, miss on every single collected company. Like, it was just, I mean, miss in the sense that, oh, I need to hit any action, I hit like Mandork.
Or I was playing Dragons, that's right. Ode to Dan Ward, little Grixis Dragons action.
Okay.
I loved the company match. The company match was great. Just Draconic Roar, everything.
Sure.
I built a Frontier deck recently. And okay. It's Black Red Dragons. And I have 4 Draconic Roars and 4 Unlicensed Disintegrations in the deck. I'm playing Smuggler's Copters, Scrap Heap Scroungers, and Hangerback Walkers in the deck.
Okay.
So I basically have 8 removal spells that bolt you, and it's phenomenal.
Okay.
That's Goblin good. Rabble Master.
Sure.
So I can just go turn 2 removal spell, turn 3 rabble, and then just go kill you. It's kind of fun. I haven't played a Frontier match yet, but I want to now.
Okay. Frontier is also kind of one of those sweet formats.
Yeah.
So.
I think the sweetest part about it is we get to go back and play with a lot of the cards that we really, really loved from the past.
Right.
And get to have a lot of fun with more cards in the format being more diverse. The one thing that I wish we could have Theros legal in the format and just Theros.
Okay.
So we can get like the Elspeth Sun's Champion, the Scrylands, and all the other stuff. So we can have like the actual Abzan control deck back.
Okay.
You know, I think the format would open up a lot more if we could have that.
I think you could argue that the idea of a new format is innovation, right? You're Absolutely. Trying to go for new things. I think kind of one of the problems with Modern, and another reason why I don't necessarily care for Modern, is that it really does feel like a rehash of the best hits type thing.
Yeah.
Right? Like, what have we, like, really not seen? Like, Jund is one of those songs that's been, like, just...
Sung for ages.
It's played on repeat over and over. Nothing, not that there's anything wrong with Jund.
I play it on repeat.
Right? I'm a firm believer in the Black Green decks. Yep. But, you know, that's a rehash. Infect was not around before the iteration. So, Infect was, it did see marginal play in Standard, but, obviously, the pump spells that were modern. Yep. Valakut, obviously, the Scapeshift deck, that was an old extended deck before we saw, before Modern came along, right? Yeah. So, like, you know, these things, while they're cool, I don't necessarily want to see, you know, them done over. Yeah. Which, granted, Frontier may or may not be some decks done over. People are arguing that.
They definitely are, like, yeah, the company
like
and the Rally
Red,
deck.
Rally yeah. decks.
They're like old standard decks with a little bit of extra spice thrown into them. And like that's kind of why I want the Theros cards, because there's a lot of really powerful Theros. Like I get Stormbreath Dragon back, then I can play more dragons in my dragons deck.
Sure.
So, Elspeth Sun's Champion, another extremely powerful Planeswalker. You know, I think there is good, just overall, we get Thoughtseize too.
Right.
So I think there's some really, really powerful cards in Theros, and I think bringing Theros into Frontier I think would be awesome. That's a personal thing to me. We get Scrylands for everybody. You know, each color had their Scrylands, so we get more Scrylands for all. I think that just makes decks better, and I think, you know, we can have a much better time with all of that.
Mm-hmm. So this is quite the judge call here. I imagine they're still arguing about the timing of the actual Cletus itself, so...
Yeah, I think they're arguing about whether or not Fabiano should get the token.
You're right. I imagine the token is what's being moved... Like, yeah. On and off the table.
Yeah, we have an actual KGS zombie token now. But yeah, I'm not sure. Again, we talked about how it's a replacement effect, and it's...
It's not a trigger. It's not...
Can't not do it. It has to happen.
Right. The replacement has to happen, and as a result of the replacement happening...
Yeah, you get a zombie 2/2. Token. This is the biggest disadvantages of being down here instead of up there at the table itself. We can't exactly hear what's going on, what's being argued. We have to rely on hearsay just to figure out even what's going on.
So to kind of bring it away from what's actually happening there, how do you feel this matchup actually plays itself out? We kind of saw how the games went.
Yeah.
Like, who do you think is favored? Where do you think it slants?
I want to lean towards Frank, because I think if Frank fetches properly in the early turns to get his basics online, to go around the Blood Moons, then we have more early plays. And it's one of the things, like, if you don't have, you know, green and white to be able to cast your Kitchen Finks on turn three, you have the green you need to collect a company on four, right? And that's the biggest thing, because, like, that's a one spell that's going to get you two creatures. So if you can't cast one or two creatures in your hand for a sacrifice of being able to cast two creatures with one spell, I think that's a proper sacrifice, and that's what we should be gearing for. But, you know, the fact that we got our forest and we're able to cast more of our spells now, definitely good. You know, the Court of Calling for the Selva Spirit put us back to relative board parity, but I think that we each have two attacking and blocking creatures, the Thrun and the Cletus versus the Voice and the Tarmogoyf. Fabiano has two Planeswalkers to go with that and a Snapcaster Mage. So I think we're definitely leaning towards Fabiano, but I think Frank has an advantage in the fact that his creatures just have so much value that we should have a better matchup this. We've had some really slow starts, I think, on Frank's side.
Right, right. I'm inclined to agree. I think this matchup does, I think, favorably in Frank's court. I think just, like, as we mentioned, a lot of the 2-for-1s, a lot of the recurring threats that are just problematic to deal with.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, while you're playing with a bunch of dumb dorks, all these dumb dorks are 2-for-1s.
Yeah.
Right? Which is kind of the bane of the control decks, because there's no good, clean answer other than you have your Damnations, but you're not really going over the top.
Mm-hmm.
And this deck does such a good job of going wide.
Yeah. So I, like, shout out to Jund right now, but, like, the reason Jund has such a better time against like this is we have Goyfs of our own.
Right.
And they can't easily get rid of the Goyf other than the Path to Exiles.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I can, you know, turn one discard into a turn two Stonewall and not let them do anything for the rest of the game.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then I can find removal spells, I can find my main board Kalidus's, and I, you know, I have a much better time in that situation. So it looks like we got that sorted out. I don't see the zombie token, which is weird to me.
Right. We can talk about that a little bit later, but again, not to get away from the game. To my understanding of the rules, that's not something that can be missed. I think you have to, because it's a replacement, it's not a trigger, it's not something that can be missed. And I don't think the game has progressed far enough that it can't be rewound and brought back to where a zombie token can be brought to.
Here's what I think about this, and this is what the chat is saying, I think, brought up a really good point. Is the token technically would be irrelevant because of the damnation. Right? So the Selfless Spirit gets sacrificed prior to the damnation. Fabiano got it after his Selfless Spirit was sacrificed, so it wouldn't have the indestructible ability. And Varl's is a phenomenal draw in this situation. The ability to regenerate itself and make creatures bigger.
Right.
It's just huge, huge game. And our Spellskite blocks Kalidus very, very well.
Yep. So now game has kind of swung the other way with Vel'Roz. Like, again, as you mentioned, very evasive threat, a little slippery, and it does have value in itself outside of just being a creature, obviously. Like, every card in this deck does. Now you're able to rebuy some of these creatures.
Yep. And make your creatures bigger and be able to regenerate Varls.
Yep. So, two creatures coming in. Block on Cletus.
Block on Varls. Alright, so we blocked the Spellskite to Cletus. We blocked Varls to Thrun, and we sacrificed the Spellskite to regenerate Varls.
Okay.
I'm not a huge fan of that. Now we have a...
Okay, this is interesting. So now we have a Damnation coming in.
So I would sack the Goyf to Varls right here.
You can't regenerate it, though.
What? Oh, yeah, it can't be regenerated.
It can't be regenerated. So board resets.
Board resets. Everything goes away. We get two... So actually... I would have sacrificed everything.
Oh, you'd sacrifice the board.
Yeah, because then we don't get any of the zombies. I don't think Varls can sacrifice to himself, though, can he?
I do not. I think it's sacrifice another creature.
Yeah. So we should have a zombie token then, shouldn't we? For Gerard's side? It
depends on the timing. It feels like things were a little bit ambiguous there. I didn't quite follow what was happening, because I think we just saw some creatures get mishmashed and put in the graveyard.
Absolutely.
So not clear.
There's a lightning bolt. Shout out to the double to all the blocks made by Frank to not die to bolt.
so that's a... So Bolt plus Cletus, I think, does put the nail in the coffin here.
I think we should have another zombie.
But I wonder if it's off screen. Okay, it's just okay. Barely on camera.
Yeah, we just got the zombies.
Yep, we
were waiting for the actual token.
Yep.
Lost a forest and a bird and a scooze.
So flash track on Sierra Bridges here. I think I'm inclined to say the game is probably in the bag.
Yeah.
Fourth best draw here.
With a Kalidas on the floor and Frank having nothing on his side.
Right.
I believe that's a lock.
I think the best draw is Collected Company here. He would need to draw Collected Company, hit perfects. I'm not quite sure what his hits would be.
Yeah, I think still it's not good enough.
Yeah. So there's a handshake, scoops him up.
Good game by Gerard. Looks like the timer, it looks like we're over time already.
Yep.
So we're going to be.
Daddy is ready. The refs are ready. Are you ready?
Breath Exemplar on turn two. Attack you for seven.
Whoa.
We'll see you next week. Have a good
one, guys. Thank you.
12:30. We'll be back and better than ever.
Woo! Puppy!
Oh, I'm doing a dab.